today we're talking about helping, the psychology of helping.
Who helps? Right? Why do people help? What kind of people help?
There are some of the factors attributed to helping others. Right? So let's think of some of the why, let's think of some of the who, and let's think of some of the where. Who here finds themselves to be a very helpful person?
Well, first, before we begin,
keep this terminology in mind. Anyone knows what altruism means? Altruistic altruism. Yes.
Is that doing something without expecting reward?
Absolutely. Right. So we say maybe here. Here, selflessness. Pure selflessness means when you do something, there is no expectation that you're thinking of, no emotions that you are ascribing to, and some sense of what I get, what I'm going to do, some of the factors attributed. So now that we understand what that is, who here is helpful?
How?
In what way? Sometimes you may not want to, but you help. Do you find that to be the case all the time?
Yeah, I think
that's right. Are there cases where you're not, where you feel like you're not doing it?
I guess it depends on the situation.
Okay, so now we just describe and say, why? Okay. Right? So we say situation. Situation such as what? Situations.
If I have to drive too far.
Right. Well, helpful person. Yes, what?
So I'm not sure if I'm altruistic, but I think I was raised in a household that was very prove your worth. Like, you're my son. You do a lot of work and do things for me, just like that's what you do. So it's not like I want to give, but if I don't, I feel guilty. So
okay. So my factors. Here I found two factors in your statement. One is guilt, but the main one is your training. Right? You were trained to essentially do some sort of work in some capacity.
Yeah.
Just call it up. Who else? A helpful person. I think going back to training, what other individuals or groups are training to help? Yes.
Teachers.
Those who have experience in a field. Those who have experience in a field.
Think of occupation. What occupations help people?
Nurses.
There you go. Right. So we say, hey, some people are actually trained, police, right? firefighters,
vets,
veterinarians. Okay. So these people who are trained, do you believe that it's a personality? That someone says, I would like to go to a profession that helps, that is selfless acts on a daily basis as part of my occupation, or is it for some other reason? I'm sure fully
honest. I don't think you can say yes for all those groups.
Yeah. What would be some reasons you think that would contradict altruism for those people?
High level doctors, I think, have
So, titles of the story. Right, so we may understand at the basis that very few human beings exhibit altruism, or we could ascribe to altruism, right? Pure selflessness in terms of giving and helping others to some degree, right? There's usually some sort of factor. So sort of two stories. One is the parable of the Good Samaritan. Anyone familiar with that parable? Someone give us a synopsis of the parable or something.
A Samaritan is walking from town to a new town, and on the way he is jumped by a group of men, beaten, his possessions sold on the dead, and two high Jewish officials walk by and beat them, but one walks by a lowly Samaritan, helps the man who was left for dead inside the road, and takes care of all his needs and takes care of everything.
Excellent. Right? So we say, man is beaten, stripped of his clothes, left on the side of the road. A priest, Jewish priest, and a little Levite, right, who is a Jew, walks past his individual, right, Levite is an assistant to a priest back in old Judea. And they see this individual and they walk past him. Person happens to be a Jew too. Now, Samaritan, I believe he described as a very famous sort of moniker for, is an enemy of the Jews at the time. They're viewed as enemies, right? So the Samaritan sees this individual, regardless of him knowing that he's an enemy of the person he's about to help. He helps him anyway. Takes him to an inn, pays for everything, and gives assistance. Right? So, in essence, that's sort of the clear sort of typology for selfless, altruistic, if one helps an enemy, right, a perceived enemy. So, two, gave unconditionally. Three, didn't have to, right? Whereas the others who were part of the same group, and quote unquote, religious, serving God, didn't help. So what does that teach us? That teach us that regardless of human belief, right, it still doesn't give a high likelihood degree of helping others. All studies suggest that people who exhibit religiosity are more apt to give. They do give. They don't give more to others, right? They give more to the in group. They're in group givers. So they do give more. Right? Yes.
I don't know if I'm
in group givers. So we determine that, hey, regardless of religiosity, doesn't dictate you being an altruistic giver, right? You can't be a giver, but just not an altruistic. You still have a bias to some degree. In terms of second story, there was a study in the 1970s in which case they had two groups of seminarians, right? Those who were studying theology, and they gave half of the group papers to write about this Samaritan parable. The other half did not have to write about this. And it gave them a certain schedule, which means that their next class was going to be very quick. They had to get to it once they left this previous class. And along the journey, they see someone in the hallway. And this person in the hallway is an actor, right? Very disheveled, coughing, looks like he's sick, really, really needs help. And what they found is kind of the same thing, right? People didn't give, the people who were writing about Good Samaritan parable did not give or stop or help or assist in anything for this disheveled person because of why, right? We say situation of time. So now we think of factors. Time is a factor. Is time a factor for you giving this one?
If I'm interrupting, but I was going to say, would you, the who of who is altruistic, would you agree it's those who have empathy?
As all right, well, yes, we'll get to that.
Okay.
Empathy is a complicated thing.
Awesome.
Right. Remember, we're talking about behavior in a social context. We're thinking of functions, function of environment. Right? We'll come back to that. But if you're talking empathy, what is empathy? What's your definition of empathy?
I think the thing I've been looking at the board so far is a lot of sympathy. Those who, like nurses, like police officers, like firefighters, generally those people aren't people who had their home burned down or really needed nursing care or that sort of thing. Most of these are people who say this is the right thing to do and I want to do this. However, I think in the situation where you see someone on the side of the road, the people who are going to stop, at least in my experience, like the people who stop and help homeless or the people who've been homeless before, people who care about people who are depressed or the people who've dealt with depression.
Absolutely.
It kind of gets you that in group because you understand who that person is and you, again, like do unto others what I wish had been done.
Alright, so what we're describing is what social psychologists describe as pro-social behavior, right? The people who are police officers, firefighters, nurses exhibit pro-social behavior. Are they doing it for altruism?
I don't know, but maybe we should say we're not too sure, right? You can't say definitively no,
can't
but
say
also it's not 100% yes.
Yes. Pro-social behavior. Pro-social behavior means you're doing it in the context that you see a bigger or greater good versus lesser evil. It's greater good for you to help others because you're going to help build the society at large, as opposed to not doing so because you know we all did that society itself would collapse, or a group would collapse, or a culture would collapse. Whereas altruism is something completely different. What Will is describing is empathy. Empathy is complicated because we say, can I place myself in the shoes of you? Can I see myself through your eyes, your emotions? I got to understand exactly what you're going through. I say, you know what? That doesn't feel good. I don't want to feel good. Therefore, I support you. Because I can hear what you do. That's essentially what empathy is. Placing yourself in the same perspective of other people. All right. Who will help? How can we increase helping? Taking social psychology into life. All right, so we say altruism is a motive to increase another's welfare without regards to one's self-interest. So we say, well, that's very rare. Helping acts identify circumstances, performance, motivations. What are our motivations to help people? Usually there is a motivation. When I went to South Africa for the first time, I saw such extreme poverty because in Johannesburg we have things called townships. Who ever seen the movie District 9 in the 80s? Okay, that's filmed in Johannesburg, right? It's townships. Townships are like a million people, sometimes 2 million shacks, big shanty. And going there, seeing the level of poverty, violence, really, really shocked me. And it really changed me in a way to want to help. Now, I started to sort of introspect out why I really wanted to help these individuals. Well, I said, first, I grew up poor. So you think poverty is a factor into wanting to help other people who are poor? What do you think? You think that's a big factor? Right? Yes. Right? Poor people give more than rich people. Right? Rich people, wealthier nations, such as the U.S., give more money. So we say give more by incidence, by circumstance. Poor people do. Right? Give more in terms of accumulation of actual dollar amount. Yeah, wealthier people can give more, but the motives are different, right? You said one can have empathy, one can have sympathy or some other motivation, right? All right, do we think that this theory of social exchange, right? Interactions are transactional, that aim to maximize one's rewards and minimize one's costs. In any sort of social engagement or relationship, are we thinking of a cost-benefit analysis? Do you do things for people thinking of what am I gonna get from this? Right? Who believes in that? Who believes that most interactions are transactional? Most human interactions. Hmm. Anyone disagree? Think of even an intimate relationship, right? Most relationships are transactional. Unless we have some sort of pure love for someone, we do it in addition, which is rare, but it's usually only done in children. Corporate social responsibility will come back. What else? So we think of culture. Do you think culture has an impact on giving? Does your culture influence your capacity to help? What do you think? And if so, why?
I would say yes, because we talked about that one day in class where there's the two types. There's the individualistic culture, and then there's the communicative culture. And I feel like the communicative culture, if they see one member not doing so well, they'll come together. Whereas the more individualistic, you feel like pull yourself out by the bootstraps. Here's an example, here's what they did, you figure it out.
All right, so Clark says left the mix of culture is more likelihood to give the individualistic cultures. Do you see a sort of any sort of bias in their giving in collectivism? Do you think that they give unconditionally to anything?
I don't know.
Right, we say most likely we just saw even with religious individuals, right, which is a cultural factor of religion. We see that people usually give more to Yankee. Asians tend to give more to Asians, blacks tend to give more to blacks, Hispanics tend to give more to Hispanics. People have a tendency not to go outside of their groups to just unconditionally give. Usually there's a sense of familiarity or something. So, yes.
While we're talking about individualism and collectivism, is there any studies or do you know about collectivist cultures not being okay with an individual being falling behind the group? Because I've seen where you hear a lot of, I guess this isn't a good example, but I have friends who are from Eastern Europe or Asian Eastern cultures and stuff, like an Indian friend and Chinese friend, and they talk about how it's like not really okay to like be depressed or stuff like that. Maybe it's just mental health in those countries, but it's like, oh, I fall behind the group and now I'm making the family look bad. And it's not I'm getting support from the group, it's no, you're not supposed to be this way, just be like the group.
No, I don't, because no. You think making the family look bad, there will probably be a push for correction because family integrity and reputation is so important that it would be hidden, right? So there's a tendency to hide these sort of failures. Because the family is seen almost as like a corporation or a brand, or stuff like that. Here's something that's just an observation. How many times in your life have you went downtown Chicago and saw an Asian homeless man begging for food? Never seen it. Never happened. Right? Never seen a white homeless man, a black homeless man, same quite a few. Never seen a homeless American who's Indian. Not gonna see it. It won't happen. Those particular cultures usually take well care of themselves, but you also won't see Asian politicians. You won't see absolutely 100% in Congress. They don't take care of the community, very insulated community, as well as the community. But we say also, too, very insulated and in group helping. balance of yourself, right? You feel bad about the situation, and maybe you feel something, religious, spiritual issue, karma of some degree, you want to correct it, and there's a sort of that democratic system in the universe. You feel that you want to correct it. Why do we think that guilt plays such a huge role in people helping? What do you think the sort of psychological mechanisms? What does it have to do with the self?
Say you do something and you feel guilty about it, even if you do something good that's like totally unrelated, like giving to a homeless person, you're going to feel like, okay, I'm not as bad of a person. This sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like a little new reward, I guess.
Yeah, it's almost a self-worth, right? You increase your self-worth to some degree, and do you think that's purely for yourself or also for others? Do you think that most people do that? Do you find that most people go helping random people without telling someone? Or do you still think it involves the past validation? That self-worth is still here?
I think if it does happen to a lot of people, most of the time it's like, okay, I want to make myself look good. But if they themselves know, like obviously you would never know if somebody else is doing that, like without that, but if they themselves know, then I guess that was kind of hard.
Yeah.
Like, you would know.
We have two phenomena. One, feel bad, do good, right? We say profound grief, right? Someone dies, something tragic happens. Now we have this incessant, intense need to step our game up. Now we care, now we help. Before we didn't even call the people, before we didn't even check on the people, right? But something bad happens, which goes to show that most of helping tends to be very selfish. Usually directed at self in order to make ourselves feel better about the situation. If the bad happens, I need to correct something that you're gonna say something.
Yeah, the thing I'm thinking about is the guilt. I mentioned guilt before, when I think of guilt, it's about me feeling like I am a drain on my family unless I'm providing value. You're worthless until you provide value. So it's not, oh, I feel bad that this happened, I need to correct it. It's, I'm sitting here and I have to prove and do things to be normal, to be baseline, to be zero. And then from there, it's like, oh, and then I can make someone's day and I can do this, but it's like you have to provide value first. And that's why I go out and I help people.
But even still, is that mindset or energy directed towards your family's value on the group? Or is it purely something that's will? Is it purely something that has to do with will, or does it have to do with still family, how they perceive will and his contribution to the family?
I guess it's family. Because if I can get away from the family and that sort of stuff, then I feel better. But when I'm around them, it's like I always have to prove my. So it's like if I avoid them and I can get away from them and stuff, it's like, oh, okay, cool. I still have like that baseline of like, I don't feel like shit. I don't feel like I need to do all these things. But I guess it's their influence that makes me do it at first. And that's just shape your personality.
Okay. So help shape personality over time. And then feel good, do good. Sometimes people who do good want to do good. But we say now your mood has changed, right? And we say there's another positive reinforcement there. If you do good, you're like, oh wow, this feels excellent. Did you see the response that person gave me for doing good? I have an addiction to doing good. And we say, well, still the doing good, something altruistic, just do real quick, the person or the something that made you feel good about yourself, right? But there's a phenomenon within that too. Usually when we start to give, we tend to have an inclination to give even more because we know that it makes us create this self-worth and that value those feelings, right? Happy people are helpful people. Helping softens bad mood, warm glow of success, more positive thoughts with being helpful. And then social norms, reciprocity norms, which means that, hey, I gave to you, it's normal for you to give back. This is kind of how it works within society. And then we have social capital, community health, which means that, hey, we are more concerned about our community together. And maybe that's a situation with you. You're like, hey, I do have a concern about the family. This is very important. Without them, maybe I don't have any. Right? Maybe my own self-worth is nil. So it's very important in that aspect because your mindset is framed towards helping. Gender and receiving help. Do you think there are any differences between, well, we could say, well, gender and sex, two different things, but let's try to place them together. Do you think there's differences between men and women in terms of helping people? And if so, what are your thoughts? What way? Most of the studies suggest that there's equal giving amongst women and men, with the exception that men tend to give more to women.
What do I get from it? And give because what do I get from it? Oppress women, women over something like that.
Why do you, anyone else? So we say man's role in society as a provider, right? Maybe men perceive women as the more fragile of the sexes, more vulnerable within society. Obviously, if they bear children or have children, we see that as something that we should have more sympathy for, right? To some degree. Other factors attributed to health. What do you think are some of the other situational things? We said time was a big one. If you're in a big rush, you might pass the homeless guy up and be like, hey, I just don't have time to help you. Somebody else is. What are some other factors you think contribute to health? Think of external. Right, one of the big ones is the weather. People tend to give more when there's good weather. People tend to give better gift. People rise in the summertime. They don't do that in the wintertime. People tend to give more money during warm months, warm climates. People tend to give more in warmer environments, period, as opposed to colder or harsher environments. What do you think of that? Why does weather play such a huge factor?
Would it be because, let's say on sunnier days, people are usually a little happier. It's nicer weather, they feel better, they're getting sunlight. And then you get rainy days, and usually people always are like a little, sometimes under the weather, or like they're feeling sick. They're like, oh, this is just depressing weather outside. I'm just a little more depressed today.
Yeah. And so we say there's a transference, right? A transference of energy, a transference of happiness, there's a transference of something. If you walk in Chicago, it's like 5 degrees outside, you feel like a crap. Why would you help somebody? Kind of want to transfer a crap to them? No, right? You're going to do that when you feel great, you're having fun, having a conversation with your friend, walking down the street, you're like, hey, you know, it's going to be fine, right? And going about your life, as the weather is great. Whether it's crappy, all you're focused about is your own survival, how cold you are, how can you get warm. Probably may not even want to reach in your pocket and pull your hand out because it might get your hands cold or something like that, right? A lot of factors contribute, say that we're very sort of self-reserved when it comes to climate, the weather. What are you going to do? All right, and lastly, we'll talk about some attribution, right? Some attribution theories, right? So we say, well, we have a stimulus, right? Stimulus is person in need of help. So we get two. Two sort of attributes, right? External or internal, right? So why we attribute this uncontrollable by ourselves, or controllable by ourselves, or uncontrollable by others, whether we attribute their need for help, or we contribute internally, we say it's controllable by them. So usually we say, hey, I see someone and I think they can help themselves, right? Or we view someone, we say, I don't think that they can help themselves. Therefore, I should do something to help them. So we say that could be a factor when it comes to gender or sex, because maybe we feel someone to be in a more vulnerable position. If we see someone injured versus uninjured, that may be an attribution into whether we're going to help them. We say they have a physical inability to help themselves. Right? And then we say there's the emotional part. Then we say the emotional part is whether we get sympathy or no sympathy. Now, we're not really dealing with empathy in this one. We say sympathy. That sympathy is not altruistic, right? We say it's pro-social. We just feel some sort of guilt or shame about that person's situation. Not necessarily that we can understand their situation or been in the same situation ourselves. We just feel an emotion that makes us feel sadness, feel bad. Really, so we come down to it, we say giving is about an exchange of feeling good and feeling bad. Either you want to feel good because someone else feels bad, you want to change your situation so that you can feel good, or you genuinely want them to feel good by making yourself maybe even feel bad. That would be altruistic. Right? So I don't care about myself, but that I'll give away all my money. So that someone else, I could just see the smile on their face. He said it's very rare. You tend to do that with children. I just want to see the smile on my son's face. Not broken. Right? Unconditional sort of giving. And sometimes no sympathy. So think of, like we may have discussed this before, people who join these charitable organizations or join the 5K run, the marathon. Save the whales, save the trees, save the birds, save the planet. Is that just because they purely want to save that particular thing, that object? Or do they want to satisfy something internally, you know, themselves, to have a reason and, to create an identity of being a good person? By my house, there is a Louis Vuitton, big store on Michigan Avenue, right? And like, for the past 2 weeks, those familiar with PETA, they've been going out there and protesting loud, right? Really loud. Like I stay in a high rise, like a penthouse or whatever, and I could hear them from like 3-4 blocks away. Loud, full of phones, etc. And And so I think of like, well, I went and talked to them a couple of days ago. And, you know, trying to really just have a basic conversation, trying to figure out the psychology. Are they really there to save some animals? Or did I pick up any sort of semblance of, they just want this identity to feel good? We all want our identity. We all want something to make us be perceived as a good human beings to others, right? So who are we doing it for? Are we doing it for some altruistic sort of idea and ideology? Are we doing it for ourselves? What I kind of get, right? I have no data to support this at all. What I kind of get was most of the people out there, they just love being part of their group. They felt empowered that they were doing something in terms of their group. And to me, the same way, since it's kind of anti-social behavior, it's going against the norms, right? That they felt even more empowered that they were doing something other than the norm. So that was my sort of perception. I'm like, well, why are you going to kind of look at the kind of relationship with the trend across the streets? Why are you picking on this place or whatever? So some people have absolutely no sympathy for it. It's really just a very selfish, narcissistic sort of motive in order to create value within ourselves so that we are able to present to others, look at me, I'm such an awesome, pious, charitable, good human being amongst human beings right now. We don't care. All we need is a reason. We'll always pick one reason, right? We'll always pick one sort of reason why to come back. Either it was the animals, right? And I think I may have walked past the next day eating a ham sandwich. We may not have liked that. So other people could be religious motive. There's a helpful motives, you just need a reason, right? And that reason is usually a very internally selfish reason when it comes down to it. All right, I think we'll end this for today and continue it on Thursday. In terms of work, how's everybody doing? Everything in? All right. Like I said, yes.
I have a question about the arguments papers. So on the syllabus, you have different options for topics than you do with posting. So which one should we choose?
Oh, yeah. You know, I leave it to yourself. Pick your own.
Okay.
Yeah. I said pick your own. If you did use the ones that are on there, no penalty of anything. Yes, sir.
How many papers are we using?
Four. I believe argument papers.
Two or four.
Yeah.
Influence are also discussed. Students are 2 and 2.
Four influence. And the arguments, you know, you won't get penalized for coming up short on pages or words. Just write a decent paper, right? I'm not one that believes in someone say, oh, you need to have exactly 500 words. 7, 8, 9, 10. No, I don't think. Why don't you write something very substantive, right, relative to what you're talking about, to get your expression across? That to me makes more common sense. Yeah.
And then it also says that it requires certain articles that we have to cite. Can it only be like psychological articles, or can it be like, I don't know, like a lot of the questions that came up?
No, I mean, whatever you have sort of a valid article, right? You know, something valid, a valid publication, something scholarly, something maybe not too scholarly, something like that. But just use your better judgment so that it's not just a crap. All right, yeah, try to get everything in. We got about 3 weeks left, so I'm trying to get things in as soon as possible. Sounds good? And I think maybe that last week we're gonna, you know, we'll skip having a final and we'll maybe do some sort of in-class project, in-class assignment.
Friday of finals week.
Yes, so we'll end there. So we're not going no further past the 15th of this, right? So we feel we've got 2.5 per week. All right, any other questions? All right, I'll see you on Thursday.